Hello, everyone, and welcome to Hockey Night in Canada Online. I'm your host, Rob Pizzo, once again alongside Mike Brophy from cbcsports.ca. And Mike, two games last night, two teams moving on, two teams trying to figure out what went wrong. And you know what? We may be saying that tomorrow because we've got two big games tonight as well. We're going to go through all of that in the next 15 minutes. But before we do that, let's let you know how you can get in contact with us. Jump on Twitter at Hockey Night, at Rob Pizzo, at Hockey Brof with the hashtag Hockey Night, or you can jump on Facebook at Facebook/Hockey Night in Canada. So let's get you caught up on what did happen last night, starting with the series you saw on Hockey Night in Canada. The New York Rangers trying to complete the comeback. They were down 3-1. And yeah, this is what you expect from Brian Boyle. Behind the back passes and then finishing off a great tic-tac-toe.
Pretty good for a big man.
Absolutely. That gave the Rangers a 1-0 lead. Pittsburgh did tie it, but then the man everyone thought was going to be bought out at the end of the season, Brad Richards, fourth goal of the playoffs, would prove to be the game winner. But we do have to give a lot of credit to this man, Henrik Lundqvist. You know what? I don't know if we're spoiled or what with this guy, but when he has amazing performances like this, it seems as though we just kind of expect it. He is the reason they stayed with that lead all third period. The New York Rangers come all the way back to beat the Pittsburgh Penguins. Final score in this one, 2-1. First time in history they rallied from a 3-1 deficit. Then you had the defending champs. They didn't want a game 7. They wanted to finish off the Minnesota Wild in game number 6. Versteeg opened up the scoring there. This game would need overtime. And in a shocking turn of events, Patrick Kane scores an overtime winner that no one really knew was in the net. I think he's done that before. In fact, 7 of the 8 Chicago Blackhawk game-winning goals in the playoffs have come from either Jonathan Toews or Patrick Kane. They are on to the conference final. So 3 of the final 4 teams in the conference final, original 6 teams. That's pretty cool.
Unbelievable.
What did you think of last night's games?
Oh, I thought they were very exciting. I think the passion's starting to mount. I guess as long as the series continue to go longer. There was a little part of me kind of hoping we'd see 4 game 7s in the second round. But at the same time, it's a grueling thing for the players to go through. So I'm sure the players on the winning teams are very happy that they've advanced and get that extra day or two off.
They certainly are. Let's get to some of our questions coming in on Facebook and Twitter. Our first one deals with, wow, shocking, Sidney Crosby. How did Crosby and the Pens let that happen? That's from Cheryl Bunt.
Well, that's the million-dollar, multi-million-dollar question. Sidney Crosby clearly not playing like the Sidney Crosby we've come to know and love. You know, one goal in his last 18 playoff games is absolutely inexplicable. The Pittsburgh Penguins had a commanding 3-1 series lead, playing against a team like the New York Rangers that earlier in the playoffs looked to be so tired.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what, this big Boyle, he had a great series, pestering Sidney Crosby as much as he did and then contributing on offense. I love that behind the back pass there by Marty Stanlouis. Look at that pass. That's one of the best passes I've seen in the playoffs. And you're right, all the talk about buying Brad Richards out, maybe that talk now turns to maybe they think about buying out Rick Nash. Still can't score a goal in the postseason.
I will say this, and you were talking about a point in this series when we were calling the Rangers old and slow, and I certainly don't want to sound insensitive to this, but when Marty St. Louis had the unexpected passing of his mother, the team seemed to rally
they
around
really
him, and they really wanted to win for their teammate. And I don't know about you, bro, if I was on my couch watching a guy score on Mother's Day after his mother just passed away, and even I got emotional, and this just seems to me like a team that's rallying behind a teammate and a team that's playing with a purpose, a team that's playing with emotion. It was really a turning point in the playoffs.
Yeah, there's no question. I think they're going to continue to rally around Marty St. Louis. To answer the question about Sidney Crosby and the Penguins, obviously something has to change here. I don't buy into the notion of trading Malkin. Malkin was not the problem. The NHL is a league of dynamic duels now, and you look around Datsyuk, Zetterberg, Perry, Getzlaff, Kane, and Jonathan Toews. You don't break up this. They obviously need a supporting cast. Do you change the manager in Pittsburgh? Maybe you do. Do you change the coach? Maybe.
Sure sounds
like
it.
Do you change the starting goaltender? Perhaps. But I think that you've got two dynamic guys, Crosby and Malkin. You don't move those guys.
All right, let's stay with the Pittsburgh Penguins because there were two questions that surrounded Sidney Crosby. Series 1 was injuries. Series 2 was What's he doing with all that extracurricular stuff after the whistle? And that's one of our questions coming in. Richard Niller says, why is Sid saying he isn't injured when he clearly is unable to play like he used to?
Well, that's interesting because I saw Sidney talking after the game last night. He did indeed answer the question, no, I'm not hurt. I don't know about you, Rob. I'm not buying it.
Yeah.
There was something wrong with Sidney Crosby. He didn't seem to me to be 100% healthy. He was not hitting on all cylinders. Hey, listen, he's Sid the Kid. He goes out there and gives his best every game. But when he's giving his best and he doesn't look like the player that we're accustomed to seeing, the player that ran away with the scoring race in the NHL this season, I've got to believe something's wrong. Was he exhausted? Maybe he is. You know, we talk every year about how Sidney Crosby in the summer puts so much work in and so much emphasis on trying to take his game to the next level. Maybe after year after year after year, it's finally just getting to him a little bit.
And not only year after year, I mean, when you look at this year alone, and I know a lot of players dealt with this, but Sidney Crosby went to Sochi to play in the Olympics. Sidney Crosby played a lot of minutes in the Olympics and he won a gold medal, which means he played as much as anybody else on the ice. And that adds up when you're dealing with condensed schedule, you're dealing with the travel of the Olympics, you're dealing with playing on a team that was just ravaged by injuries. It's going to eventually catch up to you, which was why I really thought we'd find out last night. Yes, I was playing with a bruised rib. Yes, I was playing with a strained groin. Yes, I was playing with something. Now, maybe Sidney Crosby doesn't want to be looked upon as someone who's using that as an excuse.
Exactly.
Maybe he is hurting, and he's like, you know what? Everybody's hurting. There's no point to even bring it up. He was asked if he was healthy, as you mentioned. He said he was, so I guess for now at least, we've got to take his word for it.
Well, sometimes we think these guys are superhuman. You look at the best players in the game and you think they're above being tired. You think they're above being injured. When the reality is Sidney Crosby, for as great a hockey player as he is, he's still a young man. And I think he just got a little bit worn down. I'm not buying into the fact that there wasn't something wrong with him.
Let's head to the other side and talk about the New York Rangers, because now you really have to start thinking of them as a cup contender. George LeBlanc says, how deep do the Rangers go? Well, they're in the conference final right now. So basically you're asking, can they go to the Stanley Cup final and can they win the Stanley Cup?
Well, they're in the final four. I still think they're long shots to win the Stanley Cup. I still think that the best teams are the Bruins, the Kings, and the Blackhawks, and I think if those teams, and even quite frankly, the Anaheim Ducks.
Yeah.
So I would rank, of the five teams still existing right now in the playoffs, I would rank New York number five. But listen, I'm not taking anything away from what they've accomplished. And as you said, Rob, they've rallied around Marty St. Louis. Sometimes that's what a team needs. They need a reason to be there, a reason to go beyond what they're used to giving. And I think that's what the New York Rangers are doing. I love the way Brad Richards is playing. I'll tell you what, if Rick Nash ever does wake up from his slumber then the New York Rangers will be that much better if he starts putting the puck in the net.
And I know we've talked about him already, but Henrik Lundqvist, anytime you've got one of the best goalies on the planet playing on top of his game, you can never count this team
out. He gives them a chance to win, doesn't he?
He every single game, he gives their team a chance to win. And if, as we've noticed, five straight game sevens now.
He's unbelievable.
He doesn't buckle under the pressure. All right, we've got a game seven tonight and a big one, Montreal and Boston. And we're going to preview the game in just a second. But we do have a question coming in about a specific Hab. Wow, look at that. PK Subban, nobody ever asks us about him. PK is the best defenseman in the league. Who would disagree with that? That's from Mitchell Reed.
Well, I can give you a list of people who would disagree. And this is not to take away from what PK Subban has done in the playoffs this year, because he just keeps making his contract demands much, much bigger. But listen, he's a great defenseman, but Shea Weber, Duncan Keith, Zdeno Chara, Erik Karlsson, Drew Doughty, Ryan Suter, they are in that group of best defensemen in the NHL. Does PK now belong in that group? I think you have to include him in the conversation. He's got a Norris Trophy, and he's been lights out on offense. And you know, if you watch the way PK plays the game, he does everything. He's a shot blocker. You know, he's an aggressive guy who loves to dish out the big hit. I don't like it when he throws that one, Rob, and he misses the guy because he takes himself right out of the play. And we all know that he's got absolutely one of the best shots in the National Hockey League. So, boom, when he gets the puck, look at that. It's in the net before the goalie can even move. He's in a contract year. He rolled the dice on the short-term contract. Now he's going to make millions.
Here's my theory on why a lot of people criticize PK Subban, or maybe don't want to put him on that list that you wrote right down there. Everything he does, whether it's good or bad, ends up being in spectacular fashion.
Absolutely.
Okay. When he has a hard, heavy shot like that, we sit here and watch and think, wow, what a great shot. When he's got a big, heavy hit, we say the same thing. But as you mentioned, when he misses that hit and he throws his bum into the boards, he's going to have Don Cherry talking about it Coach's Corner. When he doesn't, you know, stay back and take care of his defensive responsibilities, it's glaring. When he pinches at the wrong time, it always ends up with a two-man rush going the other way. I just look at him as the type of guy that's got all the talent in the world. And you look at this question, you know, from Mitchell, who would disagree with that? I would right now only because he's got some kinks in his game.
He's and a if work he can in take, progress.
He is. If he can take those kinks out of the game, imagine a P.K. Subban, and maybe people think you can't have one without the other, but imagine a P.K. Subban who doesn't take himself out of the play because he's going for the big hit or doesn't pinch at the wrong time, and we only see the good stuff, then it's going to be scary.
Well, it's part of the maturing process. P.K.'s a young man. He's obviously found success playing the way he plays right now, but for him to be a more complete team player, he's got to take that riskiness out of his game, and that's what the best defensemen in the NHL do. Even a guy like Carlson, who has won a Norris Trophy, he has a little bit of riskiness in his game, and it comes back to haunt the Ottawa Senators at times. PK's got to learn to play a bit of a safer game.
I couldn't agree with you more. You don't often hear Zdeno Chara with a bad pinch and an odd man rush the other way.
No.
That is something that the best defensemen in the world do not do, but I'll tell you one thing. You talk about the maturing process. We're seeing it right before our eyes. Every game, it seems as though P.K. Subban gets better and better. And you got to figure that playing with, you know, some of the best players in the world, I know he didn't play a lot there, but heading over to Sochi and being with Team Canada had to help in that maturing process for sure. All right, game number 7, Montreal and Boston. Time for us to preview, and I'm going to ask you for a prediction, so get one ready. But what do you expect from tonight's game? Because game 6 was all Montreal.
Well, I mean, logic would tell you that the Boston Bruins, you know, the team that won the President's Trophy and the team that has the home game would have an advantage. I love what the Montreal Canadiens have done, and I certainly think the Montreal Canadiens with a big guy like Max Pacioretty hitting on all cylinders has a chance. But here's what I worry about. I worry about the fact that David Krejci hasn't scored a goal for the Boston Bruins. Here's a guy who's been an amazing producer in 2 of the last 3 playoff years. You've got Chara being called out last game for not playing well. You know that he's going to bring it to the table tonight. Lucic, a difference maker last year in Game 7 against Toronto. He's a guy who can single-handedly mow down a team. He hasn't scored in 4 games. You know he's going to be pumped. Louis Erickson hasn't played well in this year's playoffs. Only 2 playoff goals. And then the guy who really makes it happen, Brad Marchand, has not scored in the playoffs. I mean, I just can't see Brad Marchand going through the entire playoffs without scoring a goal. So, from my perspective, as well as the Montreal Canadiens have played, the Boston Bruins have too many guys who have just underachieved in this year's playoffs. And let's say even 2 of the guys I just listed come and play their best tonight. Boy, oh boy, that could be the difference between the Canadiens winning Game 7 on the road and the Bruins winning it and moving to the Eastern Conference Final.
Yeah, and you look at the guy we're looking at right there, Tuukka Rask, who in my opinion is an elite goaltender now in the National Hockey League for some reason. And I can't even fathom a reason why. He just has a lot of trouble with the Montreal Canadiens. I didn't like the way he played in game number 6, and I didn't like really the way Boston played. They allowed that speed of the Montreal Canadiens to just dominate them, and there were times where Boston looked like they were standing still, but I think Tuukka Rask is definitely the key here. He doesn't have bad games, 2 games in a row, very often, and neither do the Boston Bruins for that matter. I just can't see them losing Game 7 at home.
You know, as we talked about yesterday, Rob, you get into a one-game showdown, and you've got a guy who's probably going to win the Vezina Trophy, and yet most people would take the other guy. Most people in a Game 7 would take Carey Price as their goaltender. That's odd to be in a Game 7 and go against the guy who might win the Vezina.
And I was saying this yesterday. I really think Jeanette Reneau, they should fly her in there. Let her sing the national anthem in the dressing room if that's what they want. Whatever they're going to do, whatever's working, keep it going if you're a Habs fan. We do have another game tonight. It's not a Game 7, unfortunately. Anaheim and the LA Kings and the Ducks looking to finish off the Kings. Can you believe that in this playoff season, the LA Kings have not won but 2 3-game losing streaks, and they're still alive? How often can you say that?
Well, still alive and still a team that many think could still win the Stanley Cup. Now, they're up against a rookie goaltender who's just stymied them. But I love what Daryl Sutter did the other day in his post-game press conference when he was asked about Gibson. He said, he's the best goalie I've ever seen. Yeah. I'm surprised.
Sarcasm.
I'm surprised we even got a goal on him.
Yeah.
And then he said, he's under a lot of pressure now. He planted the seed. Hey, you've got to really be respectful of what the Anaheim Ducks have done in this. Imagine losing 2 games at home and then building a 3-game winning streak. And again, we talk about dynamic duels. Perry and Getzlaff have been absolutely amazing. But I just like the supporting cast, the way the Ducks have played with passion, and they don't just rely on two guys. So the LA Kings have got themselves in a hole now. They've got to rely on their goaltender, Jonathan Quick, who's been hit and miss in this year's playoffs. When he's good, he's been great. When he's bad, he's been very ordinary. So it's going to be a fascinating game.
I love Drew Doughty's quote yesterday. He was asked about John Gibson. And some of the Kings have already said they're a little sick of talking about a guy who, you know, basically has about five games of experience in the National Hockey League, albeit all wins. And Drew Doughty said, well, I'd take Quickie any day anyway. And I'm thinking, who wouldn't? I think a lot of people would. I mean, we're talking about one of the best goaltenders in the world. But I think goaltending is going to be a huge, huge part of this game here. And again, Gibson, undefeated, first game in the regular season in his career, shutout, first game in the playoffs, shutout. He's been fantastic, 39 saves in his second start there as well. So I'm thinking we may see a game seven, but my predictions have been a little off as of late. Brof, as always, thanks so much for doing this.
Thanks, Rob.
Remember, this is how you get in contact with us. Jump on Twitter, leave us a message either now, during the game, tomorrow morning, whatever. We'll try to get to as many as we can, or jump on Facebook. And remember, game number seven tonight on Hockey Night in Canada, Montreal at Boston. And Ron McLean and the crew from Studio 42 will get you set up starting at 6:30 p.m. with Hockey Tonight. For Mike Brophy, I'm Rob Pizzo. Thanks so much for watching. This has been Hockey Night in Canada Online.